They're going to give you an overview of these molecules and how we create them and what they do, and also give you some insight into the preclinical data and some early clinical data that we have on them. So our company, Immunocore, is based here in the UK near Oxford. We've developed a unique biologic platform based around creating soluble T cell receptors, which I'll generally refer to as TCRs. And as has been nicely introduced, you should now know that TCRs target specific peptides in the context of class 1 HLA. And we engineer these soluble TCRs to produce bispecific drugs that modulate T cell activity. And this is why we give them the name ImmTACs, which is written out here. We have one lead internal program molecule called IMC-GP100. This is in phase 2A in both the US and here in the UK. And we're primarily targeting malignant melanoma with that molecule. And over the last 14 or 16 months or so, we've entered into four strategic partnerships with GSK, Genentech, MedImmune, and most recently Lilly. And as a result of that, I cannot give you an accurate number of staff that we have because that seems to be changing on a daily basis. But we've recently surpassed the 100 mark, so we've appreciated a healthy rate of growth. So we all know that antibodies are the traditional biologic choice for treating cancer, and antibodies make excellent therapeutics in their many different flavors. However, there's a few downsides of antibodies, and one is that they are restricted to targeting surface proteins. Another downside is perhaps that you normally need quite significant quantities of your epitope on the cell surface, so many thousands of copies potentially. So how do we Where we can only access 10% of the cancer targets, how can we access the other 90%? Well, most intracellular proteins will undergo proteasomal cleavage, and this will result in the liberation of some peptides. Some are normally in the range of 8 to 11 amino acids long, and these will be loaded onto HLA if they have an affinity for it. And then that will be transported to the cell surface, and this peptide, the specific peptide from this protein, will be displayed in the context of an HLA molecule. And we know that the T cell employs a TCR to recognize these molecules. So if we can harness this power, then we have access potentially to those other 90% of cancer targets that antibodies can't reach. And that's exactly what Immunocore has sought to do with their ImmTACs. They use a targeting end of the bispecific where we can target the HLA peptide complex. And then we have an effector end which can recruit the power of the T cells, which we know is a powerful immune cell, as Robert has already and Wolf have already shown us. So the only disadvantage perhaps to this is that we're then restricted by HLA type. We're all different HLA types. Fortunately, at least in the Western market, one in every two people approximately are HLA A2. And we do also feel that with a handful of HLA restrictions, we can cover the majority of the market. So taking a little bit more in-depth look at the ImmTAC molecule that we produce, we have the targeting end, which has a TCR where a traditional isolated wild-type TCR will be in the region of micromolar to even low millimolar in affinity. And we have to enhance that several millionfold to achieve a picomolar affinity TCR. And this is required because we're dealing with very low target epitopes on the cell surface, as low as 5 to 10, as cancers downregulate HLA, and not completely because they don't want to be killed by natural killer cells, but they can downregulate their HLA to escape immune natural wild-type TCR recognition. On the other end of the molecule, we have our effector function, which is anti-CD3 scFv, so it's a powerful CD3-positive T cell engager. We have a good-sized molecule that we believe will allow us for good tumor penetration, a good process and manufacture procedure, and we have early regulatory pathway approval from both the FDA and the MHRA to go into the clinic with these. Most importantly, though, we have some preliminary clinical data that supports the mechanism of action, shows that these drugs are fairly well tolerated, and potential signs of efficacy. So what is the ImmTAC mechanism of action? Well, here we've got our ImmTAC molecules in blue here, and the high affinity picomolar affinity of the TCR drives the recognition of the cancer cells in the context of specific HLA-presenting peptide. So effectively, what we have is a cancer cell then coated with our anti-CD3 molecule. And that, in turn, can recruit our CD3-positive T cell, which, if the epitope number is enough, which, again, we think is about 5 to 10 epitopes displayed minimum, we can then form a perfectly optimized immune synapse. And we can actually see this visually under electron microscopy, which we've done. Here's a T cell, which is not specific for cancer, and we have our cancer cell here. You can see the lytic granules at the rear. And you can see these number of engagements that the non-cancer-specific T-cell is making with the cancer cell. And this is because ImmTAC is present in this mix, and we believe that that's ImmTAC-mediated engagements. Once that optimized immune synapse is formed, the T-cell can induce apoptosis on its target through lytic granule release, and we can also visualize this very nicely by EM. So that's the mechanism of action on a microscale. On the gross scale, we can also see this in time-lapse microscopy. So in this example, we have two sets of cancer cells. One set in green is HLA relevant for this ImmTAC, but antigen negative. And the other target cell, cancer cell here, is HLA relevant, and it's also positive for MAGE-A3, which the ImmTAC is raised against. We've pseudostained unstimulated normal healthy CD8 positive T cells in blue. And hopefully what you'll see with the addition of just 50 picomolar of this drug is you'll see the green cells, which are semi-adherent, so they float around a bit. They're largely unaffected by the drug. But the red cells, hopefully you'll see classic signs of apoptosis, so membrane blebbing, rounding up, and detachment from the surface. I haven't actually checked this video, so it might not work. So I've built it up for a spectacular fail. No, that's good. So you can see down here, some blebbing all over. Wherever there's red, you see this classic signs of apoptosis. And what you can also see quite nicely is that when the video stops, where you had nice round, unstimulated T cells, you're seeing a lot of these elongated and signs of activated T cells. So what were the preclinical considerations for this quite novel technology we have? And just going back to our lead molecule, which is called IMCGP100. So introduce you a bit more in depth to IMCGP100. This is an ImmTAC that targets the GP100 peptide presented by HLA-A2, which is, I think, a fairly well-described peptide in the literature. Its original wild-type affinity that we isolated from a T-cell was 85 micromolar, and so we've affinity enhanced it 3.5 million-fold all the way up to 24 picomolar. And along with this increase in affinity comes an increase in a residence T half of receptor time, and that is about 24 hours. So essentially, once these TCRs that have been highly affinity matured see their peptide in context of HLA, they're virtually stuck on that target. On our effector end, we have our usual anti-CD3, which has an affinity in the nanomolar region and a residence time of in the T half of minutes. So as I said at the beginning, we're primarily concerned with metastatic melanoma. We have good manufacturing of these molecules and excellent stability. We have data going beyond 4 years for shelf life. We have approval to go into clinical trials by both the MHRA and the FDA. And on that note, we completed a very short and small phase zero study. We've recently completed a phase one study, which was a dose-finding study, and we've achieved a maximum tolerated dose in that. And very recently, in the last year, we've started our phase 2A study, which is a study more designed to try to tease out the optimal dosing regime of the drug. So taking a step back and looking back again at the molecule and the two ends of the bispecific, what are the considerations for going into a preclinical package? Because a normal preclinical package for antibodies may revolve around a murine in vivo model. However, our TCR targets HLA peptide complex, and the key there is the H in the HLA, i.e. human, and there are HLA transgenic mice available. However, we're dealing with very short linear peptides here, 9 to 10 amino acids long usually, and quite common between murine species and humans are point mutations, and even subtle, quite conservative changes, such as a leucine to an isoleucine, can abrogate the binding and recognition of the TCR to that peptide. So we also see, for example, with IMCGP100, that this TCR doesn't recognize murine GP100 if we pulse on cells. So we're left with a situation that if we put this into a transgenic mouse, we would get not only misleading information on the efficacy of the molecule, but we'd also get misleading information on the specificity, because all the other peptides that are presented by HLA that we want to make sure the TCR doesn't recognize for specificity are of the murine variety and not the human variety. So that doesn't sound like an optimal model to us. On the other end, we have the anti-CD3 effector function, and this is also specific for human CD3, and it does not bind to standard tox species. We could transplant in a human T-cell system, but it's not completely representative of a complete human immune system. So all this data together was leading us to go down the route of in vitro assays. But as with any preclinical model, one of the most obvious statements that you can make is that you want it to be predictive. So what are the predictions that we need to ensure we see with the in vitro data? Well, in efficacy, quite simply, we need to see that it kills GP100 positive tumor cell lines, and also that it does so in a manner that warrants clinical testing so we can establish a decent MABEL. With regards to specificity, we need to try to cover as much as we can of the human peptidome presented to this molecule. And we need to show that essentially any cell that does not express GP100 is not recognized significantly by our drug. We're also modulating the immune system, and powerful immune system modulators can have powerful effects. We all probably know about T-Genera trials, so we need to ensure things like cytokine storm don't occur, that we don't activate platelets, and we also need to address other issues such as alloreactivity. And thirdly, and this is perhaps more specifically with GP100, because it's not restricted in its expression to cancer, we know that there could be on-target, off-tumor considerations. So, for example, GP100 is expressed at low levels in normal melanocytes in the skin. So is there an acceptable therapeutic window? And as said, we've utilized in vitro cellular assays to answer these questions. So I'm not going to spend much time on this, but this is our current preclinical working model of how we test our agents. And the top two arrows represent largely the specificity testing, and then the bottom arrow is our potency and efficacy testing. And this is just to highlight how much we've actually bulked up this process since we've run IMCG-100 through it, in that the boxes with bold that are surrounded by bold lines have actually been added since IMCG-100, and those with the dashed ones have been significantly expanded upon. But as I said, I'm not going to go through that in any detail today, but I'm just going to point out a few of the key experiments that we did. So how do we go about these assays? It's very straightforward. We take our drug. We isolate human normal healthy donor, PBMC, or T cells, or T cell subsets as our effector cells, and we grow target cells on plasticware. So we look for efficacy. We're looking at our target cells to be indication relevant. So in this case, that's melanoma, and antigen positive, GP100 positive expressing cells, and also HLA appropriate. In this case, we chose HLA-A2. In terms of specificity, we use normal primary human cells that consist of a huge range of normal human tissues to ensure that we can try and adequately address the human peptidome. And of course, we want these to be HLA appropriate as well. And the main readouts that we use in Immunocore to assess these in the preclinical department are T cell activation assays, such as interferon gamma ELISpot, early cell killing indications, such as granzyme B ELISpot. We also utilize the IncuCyte platform. We've developed a T cell killing assay based on caspase activity using the IncuCyte. That's my contribution to robotics of this LRIG. And we also assess cytokines, such as using the Luminex platform to assess multiplexing of different cytokine release. So moving firstly to the efficacy side, is the drug potent? Can it be redirect T cells to kill GP100 positive targets? Well, on the graph on the left, we have five different melanoma target cells here. They all express GP100 with the highest expressor at the top and the lowest expressor down here. We have our GP100 negative control cell in black. And what I would say about this is that perhaps the MEL624 in gray is what we believe to be the most physiologically relevant in terms of epitope presentation compared with what's going on in vivo. And we've done some epitope counting experiments and some expression analysis, and we believe that that epitope number is about 30 to 40 epitopes per cell presented. So what you can see is that even at quite a modest amount of the drug, 30 picomolar, we're seeing significant killing over the time course of this experiment, which is 56 hours, of that most relevant cell line. And we're not seeing throughout any of these concentrations any real effects on our GP100 negative cell line. This is the IncuCyte platform that we use to assess this as a killing assay. And you can see at the start, the red crosses with white bursts represent dead or dying cells, pro-apoptotic cells expressing caspase 3 and 7. And we can see our two different cell lines here, and after the endpoint, we can see clear killing in the MEL624s, but GP100 negative cell line has proliferated quite nicely and doesn't seem to be affected by the drug. So we see that IMCG-P100 redirects with this and various other experiments T cells to potently kill HLA-A2 positive melanoma targets that express GP100, but not the GP100 negative targets at these concentrations. So this is all well and good because this is with normal healthy donor PBMCs and CD8s. What about PBMCs and CD8s from patients who have metastatic melanoma, our indication? We've been privileged to obtain such material from patients enrolled in our trial. So these are our late-stage melanoma patients, metastatic melanoma patients. And we've been able to expose their T cells along with the target cells and a clinically relevant dose of the drug and see exactly the same results as we see with our normal healthy donor cells. And we see this time and time again. We've looked at many different cancer T cells, and we've never seen a real difference in potency and the ability of our drugs to redirect their activity to kill tumor cells. So as with any drug, we need to establish MABLE, and we need to establish where we expect to see efficacious results. And with our drug, we were able to do this, and very encouraging, the minimal anticipated biological effect level was determined to be about 1 picomolar, which is quite good. And also, we predicted the efficacious Cmax would be around about the 100 to 150 picomolar range. So we were quite satisfied with the efficacy results of our preclinical work. But what about the specificity? Obviously, we didn't want to put a drug into someone that's going to work very well against the tumor, but also take out some of their organs. So to do that, we had our extensive panel of normal primary human cells and their subsets, multiple donors with multiple effector donors as well, and we didn't see any reactivity in the assays we looked at. So we looked at T cell activation and killing, by early signs of killing by granzyme B release and other spots. The only thing we did see reactivity of was with the melanocytes, but we predicted that. As you remember, melanocytes express low levels of GP100. However, what I would say about this is not only did we feel that the window was acceptable, so although we saw some signs of activation, we felt that there was sufficient window between the tumor and these cells, but also when we then tried to look for killing of these cells in our killing assays, we didn't see much evidence that they were actually being killed with the ImmTAC. So this seemed fairly satisfactory to us, but obviously we need to address those other sides of the immune system, modulating the immune system. So cytokine storm is a major thing to assess, and we used the Luminex to do this. And we utilized what's known as a whole blood assay, where we incubate our drug in the presence of whole blood for a period of time, and then we look at the sentinel cytokines. And what we see here very nicely is that below 10 nanomolar, so in the anticipated clinical dose range, we're not seeing any release of the sentinel cytokines at all. We can't detect that. So that was very encouraging. And this was done with multiple donors. We also did experiments to address alloreactivity, and we have an in-house alloreactive panel to address this, and we didn't see any response in that panel. Platelets have a very high density of HLA class 1 on their surface, and so we looked at them, and we saw no platelet activation. We also checked that the drug didn't interfere with blood clotting, and we didn't see any effects there either. So this is just a sample of some of the assays we did. But overall, we were very happy with the specificity of this molecule. But obviously, any molecule, as the more you give, will start to lose specificity. And with INCGP100, we determined that with our GP100 negative melanoma cell line to be at about 10 nanomolar here. So we set our target limiting dose as the absolute maximum dose that we could achieve at about 1 nanomolar. But if you remember, MABLE was all the way back here, and our predicted efficacious Cmax was here, so we felt we had a good window to work with. So how predictable was this approach? Because that's really the proof in the pudding. What about the clinical trial? So we utilized our phase 1 dose-finding study. We used a classic 3+3 dosing strategy to determine the maximum tolerated dose, and I don't really have time to go through that exactly at this point in time, but what the in vitro assays did predict is that we would see toxicities associated with the skin because we have GP100 expression, so we predicted maybe some rash. We might see toxicities associated with an inflammatory response, maybe both due to some activity on the skin, but also tumor activity. And we might see some signs of efficacy as we approach that Cmax of 100 picomolar, which would be around about cohort 6, cohort 7, perhaps. So our dose-limiting toxicity that we achieved was in determined to be dose for cohort 7 as a maximum tolerated dose, and this was a hypotension event. And subsequent treatment of patients, we haven't observed that. But we did see those toxicities we would predict, so rash, fever, and edema. And this rash can be quite bad. In the case of this trial, we did get up to grade 3 rash, but we didn't see any vitiligo, really. We didn't see massive really nasty side effects apart from this rash, and it was quite manageable. It ameliorated, and actually those patients who underwent compassionate redosing, it would often end up after several weekly doses that the rash would just completely disappear, and it was almost like treating them with PBS. So this is just to highlight the fact that as we go up through the cohorts, quite simply, that the toxicities that we observe around the inflammatory response and around the skin reactivity are pretty much well predicted by our in vitro preclinical data. And so that was very encouraging. So this phase one study was not designed to address efficacy. It was a first in man for the platform and for the drug. And it was designed to find a maximum tolerated dose, which we achieved. But if you remember, we said that maybe we might see signs of efficacy as we approached that 100 picomolar mark, which was about our maximum tolerated dose level. So did we see signs of efficacy? Well, the answer is we believe we did. So here's an example of a patient who was treated at that maximum tolerated dose with a single injection or a single infusion of the drug. And you can see here pre-screening their tumor burden there, and you can see that after day 30, they achieved a 30% reduction, which is by RECIST a partial response, after just a single dose of GP100. And following on very nicely, this is the one advantage of following Robert and Wolf, in that Robert introduced very nicely those data on durability that immunotherapies have been giving signs of promising. And this is perhaps what we're more excited about, is the durability in the patients who have decided to stay on the trial with compassionate redosing. So if a patient decides to stay on, they can undergo cycles of treatment. And the cycle at this level consisted of a weekly injection for 6 weeks, followed by a four-week break, and that would constitute one cycle. So this patient here, here's their screening scan, and you can see that as the cycles progress, they have a progression in the reduction of the tumor size, and they continue to respond as more cycles carry on, and they continue to respond, in fact, to this day in this patient. So we're seeing signs and evidence of durability, and that's really encouraging, and we're really hopeful and excited by this. So to conclude, we believe that our ImmTACs platform offer a novel and innovative platform for anti-cancer targeted immunotherapy. We have a substantial pipeline in place and substantially number of validated targets that we believe we can raise TCRs against. We also have to accept with some human immunotherapies, in particular those that revolve around TCRs, that we may not be able to get accurate information from an in vivo model. So we may need to go down the in vitro approach. But we believe that a sensible in vitro package can be predictive. And we also believe that if you ground it on good scientific status and the experiments are very well thought out, then the regulatory authorities in our experience have responded quite well to that. And finally, and most excitingly, we're seeing some responses already with our drug, and it's showing signs of maybe durability and efficacy. But more exciting, and again following on from what we've just heard, is the exciting prospects of being able to combine this with other drugs to include the checkpoint inhibitors like PD-1, anti-PD-1, anti-PD-L1, and anti-CTLA-4, and maybe finally delivering on that promise that we're making to patients with immunotherapies of not just durability, but truly curative treatments. So I'd just like to acknowledge everyone at Immunocore. When I first started at the company, there was maybe 45, 50 people, and so we used to always list everyone's name. This picture is very old, and now at about 115, far too many names to list, but we have a very dynamic team at Immunocore, and everyone gets involved with lots of different things, so it's a fantastic place to be at. And these are the sites that we currently have running trials, and we are continuing to add to that as well. And thank you for listening.